What's up guys, we are back with the new Canon EOS 700D. It's also called as Canon Rebel T5i in some countries including the US. So this guy is a successor of the quite popular but very short-lived Canon EOS 650D, that is the T4i. So in this video we're gonna show you what's in the box, we're gonna take you through the hardware of the camera, and then we'll talk about the user interface, performance, and at last we'll tell you whether this is actually a successor of the 650D and if it's worth skipping the 650D or whether it's worth your money at all. The 700D comes in a fairly compact box. This camera has an APS-C size sensor as the model name suggests. So wherever you see three figures, there are 700, 650, 600D, 550D, all those have APS-C size cropped sensors. So there you have the camera. It comes with an 18-135 IS-STM kit lens. You can also choose to have the body only or with the 18-55mm lens, and you'll have to pay accordingly. So you have some quick specs out there. That's the price with the 18-135mm lens, $77,995. So that's the MRP, but you might get it for much cheaper if you can strike a good deal with your local vendor or some online retailer. Some software information on those side, and that's about it. So we're gonna open the box and see what's in there. Yeah. So we have the digital solution disc there, some documents and CD stuff, so you're gonna see what those are. So we have the complete manual here detailed, then we have the software instruction manual, and then we have some quick tutorials here, which is cool. They see all nice, and then there's nothing much here. So we go further in and we see that there is a USB cable. It has a mini USB out there. Then we have the external charger. There should be a power cord inside. There it is, that's the power cord. Then we have solder strap. We have the battery, the protection hole, and it's an LPE8 battery. Then we have the kit lens, well protected. That's the 18-135mm kit lens. And then finally we have the 700D body here. Ooh. It looks fairly compact, not much bigger than the 100D. In fact, the 700D is almost identical to the 650D in terms of design, construction, and also quality, with minor cosmetic change here and there. We'll go through those, and then it has some nice little features that's added over the 650D, but more or less it's fairly the identical body of the 650D that you have. If you have the 650D, in fact, then we don't see any reason to get the 700D, but if you do not have 650D, you probably could skip the 650D to have this. We'll talk about all those in detail. So that's the 700D body. Yeah. The look and feel of the 700D, that is the Rebel T5i, is almost identical to that of the older 650D, that is the Rebel T4i. And when I say identical, there are very few minor cosmetic changes as well as some UI menu
changes and kind of workflows and getting into each menu types and some live views that are changed on the 700D compared to the 650D. Now when I hide this, you almost won't be able to tell whether it's a 650D or a 700D, because the mode dial is one of the most visibly prominent change in the 700D. How is that? The mode dial here, you see all the letters and pictures are embossed, whereas on the 650D they were kind of printed. Also, the mode dial is now 360 degree rotable, and you can rotate it in both directions indefinitely, whereas on the 650D you used to get stuck at sometimes. The 700D also has a slightly better build. It feels better, although does not look that better, but it kind of feel like a more premium, you know, mid-range DSLR, and it has a very cool sandblasted look, matte, so you won't have your fingerprints left over there. But then the matte over the LCD monitor attracts kind of a dust, because it's actually sandblasted. You can see the sound of my fingers rubbing there, so dust particle kind of at times gets stuck there, so you'll have to take care of that. It looks dirty at times. For example, there you see very slight dirtiness and there, you know, kind of, yeah. So another difference is that the 700D comes with STM lenses, 18-55mm, and then this one is 18-135mm STM lenses. The 650D also supports the stepping motor. Then there are a few UI changes, like for example, you now have the live views enabled on the 700D. You can particularly live view the creative scenes or those kind of the effects, the creative effects. So the front side has the autofocus SS lamp there, the IR remote control receiver, then you have the lens ring, you have two lens mounts, so this is for EF lenses, this is for EFS lenses, this is an EFS lens. So there you see, that's the white mark there, so it'll align to this lens mount. If you have an EF lens, then it will align to this mount, your contact points, and there is your mirror. Sitting behind the mirror is your sensor, so it's an APS-C size sensor, and in case of Canon, that's about 22.3 into about 14 odd mm, which is kind of slightly smaller than the ones on the Nikons and Sonys, which are 23.5 into about 16 mm. Now a slightly smaller size sensor means a slightly larger crop factor. So the Canon has a 1.6x crop factor when you compare it to a 35mm full frame camera. So when you use, let's say, a telephoto lens on this body of the same focal length as on a Nikon or a Sony, this will give a very slightly better range, because this will multiply the 35mm equivalent focal length by 1.6, whereas on the Nikon or on the Sony camera they will multiply it by 1.5. yeah, so you have the lens release button there, you have the DOF preview button, then you have the flash initiate button there, so you press this and the flash pops come out. You have the shutter release button there. Let's check out the top. So you have the command dial, the lone command dial, you have the ISO button here, your mode dial, the power toggle, video toggle lever there, so that's switch off, switch on, and then you go to the video. Then you have your eyelets for the lanyard, you have the stereo mic, your external hot shoe for your external flash, and then your sensor mark there. That's the built-in flash. This side you have a single card slot. You would have liked a dual card slot, but that's how it is. On this side you have all the ports covered by rubber flaps there. So where you have your AV out, that's the AV out or data transfer cable. Then you have your HDMI out. That's kind of looks like a full size. Yeah, so that's a full size HDMI out. Then you have, that's for the wired remote control, and then you have the 3.5 mm jack for the external mic. On the back side you have the speaker here. There you see, you have the menu button, the info button, the viewfinder. It's not an electronic viewfinder, it's an optical viewfinder. That's your touchscreen monitor, your iCup, then your diopter setting wheel there. Then that's the button to toggle between live view, and then that's the AV button, which mainly used when you're using the full manual mode, where simply rotating the command dial will change the shutter speed, and when you press this and then rotate, it will change the aperture. But it also acts as a exposure compensation scale. As you can see here, it's marked. Q will toggle between your quick functions, and then it also gives you some print settings in playback mode. So all these in blue colors are effective when you're on the playback mode. Then you have these four way buttons here, and centered by the set or OK button. You have the white balance, autofocus, those are the creative effects, and then you have your drive mode, so that you can click single photo, multiple photo, that's the burst mode. And for your information, this guy shoots at a maximum of 5 FPS. Then you can also have the self timer in the same menu. You have a playback button, and then your delete button, and then your CPU access notification light. So it'll keep on blinking when the camera is accessing the CPU. The monitor is touchscreen. I'm gonna show that to you in a bit. It's 270 degree articulating. There you see, you can go like this, you can go like this, but you cannot go this again. This, and it's, you can almost look it from all sides except from this side. So you cannot, if you're here, then you cannot look at it because it cannot go like this. But other than that, you can almost look at it from all the other sides. Below you have the tripod mount, and then your battery compartment. There you see. So this guy takes an LPE8 battery, and it's what, 1120 mAh battery. Not a very powerful battery. We'll check out in our test how many snaps or videos this guy can last in one charging. Yeah, so that's about the hardware. All in all, a very cool and rugged looking, nice classy looking camera body. Let's talk about the lens now. It's a new STM lens, so it supports IS, that's image stabilization, as well as a stepping motor. Stepping motor helps in achieving the servo autofocus feature that came on the 650 and now on the 700D. So there are only two STM lenses right now. This one 18 to 135mm, and then there is a cheaper 18 to 55mm STM lens. Now you get the 700D body only, of course, and then with the 18-55mm STM lens, as well as with the 18 to 135 STM lens, depending on how much you're willing to shell out. So there you can see it's an EFS lens. It supports image stabilizer. In fact, you have the image stabilizer button there, switch on or off. It has an autofocus thing, so you can autofocus the lens, so autofocus and manual focus. Then it also supports macro at about 1.3 feet, so that's the focus ring, and that's the zoom is not rotating because it's locked. So you can lock the zoom in case you're one of those kiddies who keep playing with the zoom. Yeah, and in the process loosening it in the long run. So whenever you're not using it, you can probably lock it. Yeah, that's the zoom. And then, as I showed you, that's the focus ring. There's landscape, good quality. And there you see, it's an EFS 18 to 135 mm. The aperture range is 1 by 3.5 till 5.6. This guy takes a 67 mm filter. Yeah, so let's go ahead and stick it to the Canon 700D. So as this is an EFS lens, so it has the white mount here. So that's the white mount. So I'm gonna match the white mount and then pull this towards the lens release button, and there you go, the 700D. We'll check out the user interface now. For that, I'm gonna switch on the device. So I'm in the still mode now, switched on. Now, if I want to record videos, I need to switch this lever to the video mode. The moment you switch on, the first screen that greets you is the info screen, which differs with the shooting mode you're in. Now I'm in auto and this info will differ. There you see. I'll go back to program, and the moment I press Q, I can now edit each of these quick functions. So there is the exposure compensation scale. So I can either alter it from here with the physical key, or I can alter it by touch. And this is a very, very responsive screen, so you won't face any lag, any inaccuracy with this touch screen. It's amazing. It's a capacitive screen, so it'll respond as your high-end smartphone would. So you select the function first, then tap it again to go to the detail, and then you select, like I'm selecting the size now, RAW, RAW plus JPEG or JPEG large. You either again tap here to select this, or you select it single and then back to do that. Basically it does the same thing. I have the metering all here. Yeah, so tap the Q button again to come back to the original non-editable info. You have the main button from here, and it's divided into the camera settings. There you see the front camera settings. You have your image quality, I've shown you just now, you know. And then you have some other settings like lens aberration correction. You generally would want to keep it enabled. And then you have some other stuff, auto lightning optimizer, which is kind of like you say dynamic range correction. You have your metering modes and ISO auto. Yeah, so my ISO is in auto, but it'll go to a max of 6400. You can press menu to come back one step. So long exposure noise reduction and high ISO speed noise reduction. I generally keep this on. You can actually switch the high ISO speed noise reduction off, because you can easily correct that in post-processing, but it's very difficult to correct the noise of long exposure. So you would want to keep that on. You have another things on the back of the camera. These settings are mainly applied to the back. And then you have some still photo settings. So you have protect and rotate and erase and whatnot there. Yeah. Now, when I go to the movie mode and I push the lever here, you would see, now when I press menu, you'd see the video menu appearing here, where you can set your continuous autofocus settings or your movie size. There you see a max of full HD 30 frame per second is what is possible, sound recording and all those stuff. Yeah, so come back to the still settings, and then you have some of your system settings. Yeah, usual supports NTSC and PAL. Yeah, so you can go back by pressing the menu button, and that's your favorite menu setting. So you can add anything here. For let's erase that to my menu, and I want to select lens aberration correction, for example. I press OK. Yeah, I select this, I press OK. Yeah, and when I
come back here, I'll see these two my saved settings, so that I can quickly save all my favorite settings here, so that I don't have to fish for them in this long menu. Yeah, you can toggle the info button. You can switch it off there, switch it on to have it display some other informations, and there is, you can also toggle the live view mode from here. So I'm in a still mode. There you see, so it's in the still mode now. The moment I press this, it'll switch off the live view mode. To record video, I need to push this lever to the video. It'll automatically come to live view mode. Now I need to press this again to start recording. There you see. So this guy autofocuses beautifully while recording, but then you see, even in program, even in aperture priority mode, you cannot actually set your aperture. Now let's start recording, and while recording you cannot set your aperture. You can only set your exposure compensation scale there, yeah, or the servo autofocus on or off. You can only set your aperture or your shutter speed manually while you're in full manual mode. There you see, now I can rotate the command dial here and my shutter speed changes. There you see, I can press this AV button here and then rotate the command dial and my aperture will change. I can also toggle the ISO now and select an auto or a manual ISO mode there. You can also select various functions in live view. So I'm in live view, then the moment I press Q, you can go to all these, and for example, now you can select your metering, you can select your drive mode. And the biggest difference of the 700D with the 650D comes in this creative filters. So now you can live preview the creative filters. When I say grainy, you see grainy, soft focus, fish eye effect, and all this stuff. So you can see all the creative effects live preview of them, which wasn't possible with the 650D. The touchscreen offers great functionality in the playback mode as well. So now when you're in the playback mode, then you can simply pinch zoom. Yeah, there you see, it's very fast and responsive. Yeah, you can also zoom in by tapping this button, by the way, but I absolutely love using the touchscreen for that. Almost feel like I'm doing this on my smartphone. You can also keep zooming it out to show various thumbnails, so only a max of 9 thumbnails per page is possible. And then you can delete one, or you can have some other stuffs as well. Yeah, so that's the playback. Practically the playback menu is all there. In general, the system of the 700D is fast and responsive, and the flag bearer of this system is the brilliant touchscreen LCD monitor. It's made of capacitive display, as I told you before, and that's absolutely a breeze while you're browsing the UI or you're browsing the media. Now the buttons give proper feedback, and there are no discomfort or that we felt, you know, operating them anyway. So they are properly elevated and very nice. So once you get used to all the buttons, you won't have to fish for them any longer. So you can just, all of them are within proper reach of your, you know, fingers, so that you can operate them pretty quickly and perfectly. Now photos, for the most part the 700D takes excellent photos. The colors are properly rendered, and although we found that the saturation is dead on the lower side, but we mostly clicked photos under overcast conditions, so we expected that to happen. However, even under enough light, there weren't
very fine details that I felt when we clicked some fine detailed objects like dogs or stuff. Then, you know, when we tried to crop the picture, we saw a lot of grains and let's say the fur there or of those animals, when all that separated to give you an indication of how detailed the photos are. Although, and the JPEGs are a bit soft as well. However, in general, under enough light, the photos were all right, and they're more truer in nature to whatever was out there in real. Under low light, again, noise start appearing beyond 6400, as in 6400, and beyond that, you can also go up till 25,600, but we would not recommend you go beyond ISO 6400. That you know, leads me to talk about how amazing the image stabilization is of the lens particularly. Now, note that Canon does not have an autofocus system or, you know, in the body, so it's the lens that has the autofocus system as well as the image stabilization system. Now, under low light, and we really mean low, I mean we stretched the camera to a hilt, and I shot it handheld with an aperture of f/3.5, ISO of 200, and I shot it at a 10 second exposure, and even then the picture went shaky. So it's only when I went up to 15 second and then 30 second the picture started shaking and blur. So in 10 second they were not that sharp, but they were, you know, I mean the low light condition that I tested the camera is, you wouldn't generally use this camera in real life under those conditions. So 10 seconds ISO 200, the image stabilization is mind-blowing. Although the lens supports macro as it's mentioned here, you can see, but then the minimum distance is a little too far. You see, the macro is mentioned here, it's 1.3 feet, it's too far. We tried it macro with this, obviously it's not, you know, 1:1, and again the macros were a little soft and the details were missing. The video recording of the 700D is first class and really takes it from where the 650 ends it. Now, in the video recording, continuous autofocus is supported while recording, and you can change your aperture, shutter speed, and ISO on the go while in full manual mode only. When you're in aperture priority or shutter priority, or even on the program mode, you can only change the exposure compensation, and you can toggle the servo autofocus. Now, because the lens is STM, it has a stepping motor, it can continuously focus, you can it can lock of, you know, spot focus on the subject as long as the subject is still, and then the moment the subject starts moving, it can switch this to a servo autofocus, which means continuous autofocus. And also the autofocus system here is very, very silent and almost instant. Is the autofocus on the 700D is one of the best we have seen. And it has 9 autofocus points, all crosshair types, although they're concentrated quite a bit, you know, towards the middle, and I like them really, you know, spread out. But then all crosshair types is something that's quite commendable. The Canon 700D is the flag bearer of the Canon's entry-level digital EOS Rebel series of cameras, and it performs like one. It's built like a premium mid-range camera, not entry-level camera. It performs you know, very well in still and exceedingly well in video. It has a amazing touchscreen. It comes with a new STM lens which has a great wide autofocus and very fast continuous autofocus, and it also has a kind of more premium looks than the other Canon entry-level cameras. So when you compare the 700D with the Nikon 5200 head-on, In terms of performance, the Nikon 5200 edges just a bit, but then the 700D holds its own fort. It has some of the functions that you would not even get in some mid-range Nikon devices or Sony devices. So all in all, it's the best entry-level DSLR for Canon till now, with a host of features. And Canon, of course, you know, experiment with all the new features on the entry-level DSLRs, and then if they become popular, then they incorporate those with the high-end devices like the 5D series. Now all the features of a premium entry level are in the 700D, and they together perform very impressively. And if you like this video, please hit the like button and subscribe us. Give us opportunity to give you more such awesome content. Thank you.